It just looked beautiful. I wanted it to be part of my story. He was introduced to me as the coach, and he said, anything you need, let me know. I was a 17-year-old girl at an all-girls school, and I was getting complimented. I was on my back with my knee to my chest, and he was like lunging over the top of me. Do the parents of the children that are sending their kids to private institutions know that they are not mandatory reporters?
That's not an easy thing to look at, but you have to look at it. You have to be honest about it.
We need to open up the doors, open up the windows, find out what's really going on.
No one told me what to do after your rape because I never thought I would be.
It's definitely a branding. Emma Willard has made a brand name for themselves, and the image that they portray is like a very self-assured woman who is educated and bright and, yeah.
I think the biggest characteristic that is common for Emma girls is that they are confident.
On a snowy day in the late 90s, then 17-year-old Kat Sullivan visited Emma Willard for the first time. The all-girls private high school is known for its academics. Its alumni include women's activist Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, and actress Jane Fonda. She was hooked almost immediately.
I think that we want them to feel like they belong, that they are cared for, and particularly in a boarding school, when we have parents that are perhaps 3 hours by plane away, or in fact they're on the other side of the globe.
Kat grew up in a middle-class family, first going to school in Dallas, Texas, before moving to Atlanta, Georgia for the first few years of high school. Visiting Emma Willard and New York was something new to her.
For me, coming from Atlanta, there was way more snow than I had seen, and it had been untouched. And looking out at the snow under the lanterns with like the Gothic architecture, it was beautiful. It just looked beautiful.
What she didn't know was things would soon go off course, and this would be a chapter that would define her.
I played on my old school in Georgia's boys soccer team, and I played junior varsity as well as varsity. So I was actually introduced to Scott Sargent when I was touring the school. He was introduced to me as the coach, and he said, you know, anything you need, let me know. So that was my first interaction with him.
Scott Sargent worked at Emma Willard since 1994. Besides a soccer coach, he was also a history teacher and was often seen with other students. Kat was beginning to adjust to school, and things were going well.
And I was just walking to the pharmacy, which is about a mile away from the school, and a car honked on the side of the road, and then I heard my name. And you know, when I turned to the side, he's like, get in the car before you break your leg. So in the car, you know, he's like, what are you doing out here by yourself? And he really just seemed like he was trying to help me.
Scott and Kat spent the afternoon running errands. When he dropped her off, he left her with a gift.
And he said, hey, wait, before you go, take this CD, listen to it, let me know what you think, and then think about like coming over with some of your friends and have pizza. You know, like that way you can make some friends and I'll rent a movie at Blockbuster.
Scott's interest in Kat grew, finding secret ways to correspond.
I had never seen AOL Instant Message in my life. So I was sitting at the computer, responding to my dad, and a little like box popped up. And I kept getting messages, and I'm like, who is this? And they're like, just secret admirer. And I'm like, okay. I would say like the flirtation started there. You know, they said, you looked really pretty today. I'm like, how do you know who I am? They're like, you know me. You'll find out.
Soon after meeting Scott, Kat was faced with a devastating family emergency.
We'd received a phone call that my mom had brain cancer, and my father was trying to communicate with me, and I wasn't able to reach him. So I was lost in the hallways a little bit. I was frustrated. I don't cry often, but I was really frustrated and tears were going to start falling.
Scott found her in the hall and offered his support and access to his office where she could feel safe.
He actually took a key off the keychain. And before I left that office, he said, you know, don't tell anybody, but yeah, if you need to reach out to your parents, just use this anytime. Just be careful like coming and going because I shouldn't have given you a key. I've gone to private schools my whole life, and there have been plenty of teachers that have been kind of like older cousins, if you want to look at it that way, where there's clearly a boundary, but it was okay to have a friendship.
Kat says Scott slowly manipulated his way into her life, even crossing boundaries.
at some point it went from complimenting me to an arm over the shoulder to, oh, your hair looks nice today. And all of those things felt really good. And then, honestly, he invited me into his office after dinner one night. He's like, I just want to talk to you. And when I went into the office, the lights were out, which I expected because I thought I was the first one there. I was trying to be very quiet because security, and I closed the door and he said, I'm in here. And I almost like screamed because I was not expecting the lights to be out and him sitting in the chair in his office. So he'd actually moved one of the chairs in his room so that I'd be sitting next to him. You know, he leaned forward and he started to kiss me. He became more aggressive senior year. He was very interested in any sexual experiences that I had had. His emails very quickly became demands,